So let's compare a CCD camera to a CMOS camera. Why would you want to buy a CCD camera for astrophotography? Well, first of all, CCD, it stands for charge coupled device. The area on the CCD sensor is divided into pixels using a series of channel stops and gates, as they are called. While the sensor is exposing, as you can see here, photons that fall on the pixel are converted into electrons and stored as charged packets. To read out the sensor after exposure, the gates are clocked that form the pixels, and this moves the charged packets down the image sensor into the horizontal readout register, as you can see below. Once in this register, CCD camera, it uses a similar method of clocking to move the charge packets one by one to an amplifier that converts the number of electrons to a voltage. Because this digital conversion happens outside of the sensor, a high quality 16-bit analog to digital converter, or ADC in short, can be used. Every pixel is also being converted using the same amplifier, which gives excellent pixel-to-pixel reproducibility. CCD sensors are therefore often called dumb sensors or passive sensors, and they require a lot of external circuitry. However, this also means that other circuits on the CCD are adding very little signal to noise, very little signal to an image. This gives us great controllability as camera designers to optimize our cameras for low light imaging. The kind of readout structure is also what allows us to dynamically modify pixel size using binning, which adds flexibility to the camera. However, all the clocking makes the sensors slow to readout. Traditionally, this isn't a problem in astronomy, where we prioritize quality over speed. CCD sensors are also relatively expensive, particularly when you begin looking at large sensors like the ATIC 16200, for instance. So what are then the main advantages? Well, first of all, a pro of a CCD camera is that it adds very little signal by other circuits that are placed outside of the sensor on the CCD, so that's very nice. You can also use binning on the camera itself to modify the pixel size, which is not included in a CMOS camera. You can use software, of course, to perform binning, but with a CCD camera, the CCD camera can do it itself. And this is sometimes very useful, as it can greatly enhance the quality of your picture. As said, it also has a high pixel-to-pixel reproducibility because it has this register and this high-quality analog-to-digital controller to read out the pixels. And it also provides you with a high dynamic range. So you will see a lot of nuances when you are targeting faint objects like nebula. You will see a lot of nuances within the nebula. They are very expensive, so compared to CMOS, you have to pay a lot of money for them. And CCD cameras are generally relatively slow to read out. So let's move on to CMOS cameras. So CMOS stands for complementary metal oxide semiconductor sensors, and they are often referred to as systems on a chip. Each pixel is a discrete element hardwired to its own readout circuit, as you can see here. This means there is no true on-chip binning, although it can still be emulated in software to a certain extent. Typically, each column, it has its own ADC, so analog to digital converter. Because there are so many, these tend to be of lower quality 12-bit ADCs as compared to the high quality external 16-bit ADCs that are often used with CCD cameras. However, as each pixel can be read individually and simultaneously, and a large number of ADCs are used, this greatly increases the read speed of the sensor. And that comes really into use when you do you want to do, for instance, planetary imaging. It also means that the ADC and image sensor are on the same silicon die, which can give very low read noise. It is important to note, though, that read noise on the CMOS sensor is linked to the full well depth, and using the sensor at its lowest read noise settings is usually at the expense of the well depth. At the full well depth we tend to use for deep sky imaging, there is actually a little difference between CMOS and CCD sensors. We also have to deal with M-glow, so having more circuits on the same die also causes the M-glow that CMOS sensors are known for in its astronomy. So you get this glow in your image. Of course, there are ways of controlling and minimizing the effects of this, both on the sensor and through image calibration. The pixel size in CMOS sensors, they tend to be relatively small due to their mass market applications. This makes the camera a great match for short focal length telescopes, which will also produce a great field of view, a wide field of view. So let's go over the main pros and cons for the CMOS camera. And we of course compare it then to the CCD camera. I think the most important reason for people to buy a CMOS is the cost. So CMOS cameras are relatively cheap as compared to CCD cameras. And for a lot of us, we are into astrophotography as a hobby. We don't want to spend our entire pension fund on this hobby, but we want to, but we are not allowed to. I know that our wives don't let us. So, cost, it is a very big pro. The second advantage of buying a CMOS camera is that it has a very high read speed. So if you are planning on using your dedicated astrophotography camera for planetary imaging, just such as the Sun, the Moon, Jupiter, Mars, Saturn, etc. You don't need it, but it is very good to have a high read speed because you have a higher frame rate per second. Which greatly enhances the quality of your images of the planets and the moons. Okay, we have a third pro. Actually, CMOS cameras tend to have a very low read noise at higher gain settings as compared to a CCD camera. This also comes with a disadvantage though, so the low read noise is very nice to have, of course, in a picture. On the other hand, it also will limit your image quality. It's also on the cons section on the right hand side, the second point, the 12-bit analog to digital converter can limit the image quality, and this is especially combined with a higher gain setting. And maybe the most basic thing I can say about it is it limits like the dynamic range you have in the picture from the faintest pixel you have with the faintest light to the pixel with which has the brightest light. When you use the 12-bit ADC and you bump up the gain, you will have less steps from the lowest end of the spectrum to the highest end of the spectrum, and so you will have a less nuanced picture. Moving on with the cons then, we also have to deal with M-glow because of all the 12 ADC converters, but they can be calibrated out by taking flats and bias and dark frames most of the time. There is also more variation in the linearity and the sensitivity between the pixels because we have multiple 12-bit ADCs that are reading out, so there can be some variation between those ADCs, which also leads to the variations in linearity and sensitivity between the pixels. As compared to the 16-bit high quality ADC which a CCD camera has, and every time the same 16-bit ADC is used. Finally, there is no on-chip binning possible, although there is a lot of software on the market that already can also do binning for you after you have taken your images. CMOS is of course the new player here in the market, and we can see that in the last decade or the last couple of years even, there has been made great progress on high quality CMOS astrophotography cameras that are affordable for the average amateur, especially the ZWO cameras. They are of high quality, And yeah, they produce, yeah, especially the higher end CMOS cameras of ZWO, at least this is my personal experience, they produce high quality images that are, yeah, they are now really competing against some of the CCD cameras that are also out there. And because CMOS is so mass marketed, it's also in smartphones, it's also used in your DSLR camera. I am like 99% convinced that in the future this technique, the CMOS technique, will even it will improve even more. And yeah, we will see what happens. Exciting times. So maybe we will end up with CMOS being of higher quality even than the CCD camera. We will see. That's it. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you learned something from this video. I certainly did by trying to find out what the differences were between CCD and CMOS. I know a little bit more about it than I used to. With that, I want to thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye bye.